Welcome to Irresistible You, Ignite Your Passion and Purpose. I'm your host, Karen Seltz. What if there was no such thing as failure? How would you operate? Who would you be if you weren't worried about failure? What if failure were merely feedback? Like this is a reflection of something else deeper that you are ready to look at. I've been playing with this notion most of the week, and I usually have a central theme of my week, and I've been selecting it now. So I've been digging deep into what exactly I'm creating, because if I believe that my thoughts create my reality, and I do, at least up here, I believe that, how do I prove that? So I've been looking deeper, like what are the things I must have been thinking in order to get me to the experiences that I'm currently having. And it's really fun if you choose to look at it that way. So what I'm doing is I'm looking at it like a scientist would, like, okay, what happens if I drop this pebble into the pond? And each pebble represents a thought. So if you think about the representation of that, you drop a pebble, which is a thought, into a pond, it creates a ripple, right? So you're sending out this radio signal to the universe, and it's invisible. Like we don't see the signal that comes in and creates a picture on our television, right? It's all these waves, it's a frequency, and it creates an image on our TV screen. And most of us don't know how that works. Some people do, clearly. So I've been playing with that, okay. And how am I feeling? How am I feeling about what I've created? Am I upset about it? Am I welcoming it? Am I grateful for it? Or am I resisting it? Am I thinking, oh, I didn't do this. This was done to me. Because all of that plays a role. And what I've discovered, like one of the easiest ways for me to see this is in romantic relationships. And when I look at the course of, I don't know, the last 5 years, for example, I've attracted a similar kind of man. Like there's been a pattern of what I've attracted. Now, what is the common denominator in that? Me, right? So I get to look at what is it in me that I am, you know, what am I vibrating at? What am I thinking that's attracting this type of man? And it's fascinating when you can look at it that way instead of, oh, I messed it up or I'm doing it wrong or there's something wrong with me. Because if you look at it like a scientist, they're not attached. It's just data. Like what happens if I try this or if I introduce this variable, will it change the outcome? So if we look at our lives that way, and I know it sounds detached, but really we are attached to all kinds of stuff that isn't fact. I mean, most of the things that we believe are complete and utter BS. And if you really take the time to look at these beliefs and, you know, examine them under a light, they're really ridiculous. At least mine are. I mean, they're so ridiculous. And like, for example, many, many years ago, before I did a ton of work, I used to have this core belief and it was in there. And even when I knew that it was silly in my head, I still believed it in my body and I behaved from that place. And that belief was that I am unlovable unless a man loves me. Like if I was on my own, single, I felt like I had no value. Now, logically, that makes zero sense, especially in this culture, right? It makes no sense. But I operated it as if I was going to die unless a man was in love with me. And think about who I attracted at that point. Is that an open, loving, welcoming energy, or is it desperation? So I attracted what? Desperate men, I guess. So as I've become aware of these things, I've been able to shift a lot of those patterns and some new ones emerged. I'm like, oh, this is fascinating. So I get to do some experiments. And there are tons of beliefs like that that I'm looking at right now. And it's, does my ideal life picture match up with what I'm experiencing right now in this environment? And if it doesn't, I am believing something underneath there that I deserve what I have right now. In whatever area it is, it could be my career, my house, my family relationships, my romantic relationships, my body, my health. I mean, it could be absolutely anything, right? So I'm starting to look at these things from that detached perspective from up here. Like, okay, so if I'm looking down at my life and I'm a scientist and I am the observer and I'm observing only facts, what other variables could I introduce? What changes could I make to my thoughts? What different pebbles could I drop into the pond of my awareness? And I'm having a lot of fun. And I always have this belief, and I truly believe this for reals, that we can either laugh and play through our lessons or we can kick and scream. And I spent so many years kicking and screaming and refusing to be wrong and refusing to learn my lesson. And so my lessons kept getting louder and louder and louder until I feel like I had no choice but to wake up and learn the lesson. We always have a choice. We always have a choice. I could have learned it, you know, 30 years ago instead of now, but you know, now's the time for me. So I might as well enjoy it. And I prefer to learn my lessons through delightful surprises and synchronicities. Because why not? Life is too short to be serious. Remember, seriousness comes from the ego mind, not our mind of love, which is our God self, our divinity. So the title of this episode, I called it, "You Are Always Succeeding." The question is, exactly what are you succeeding at? Because we are always successful at drawing to us that which we think we're worthy of. So if we're drawing to us bosses that abuse us and want us to overwork and underpay us, that's what we believe subconsciously that we're worthy of. So we get to bring those subconscious beliefs up to the surface and shine a light on them and say, huh, that's fascinating that I believe that. What's one way that I could treat myself better? What's one thing I could do? Well, you could set a boundary. You could say, my workday ends at 5. I'll be happy to look at that tomorrow when I come back in at whatever time you come in, right? Like you just set a boundary, like period. Like, yeah, I know in the past I would stay, and I've decided I'm going to love myself now. And my workday ends at 5. So what? Notice the people that set boundaries, they don't do that to them. They give it to those of us who are people pleasers. And that used to be me. So I say those of us. It's a process of taking your power back, because you and only you have given it away. If you have something you don't want, if you get to look inside. I know it's super fun, right? But what else do you have to do? I love this too. I just got back from a week long with Dr. Joe Dispenza, and he was talking about people that would do their first meditation there and they're like, oh, I didn't connect to the divine. And he would say this over and over, you're just not that good yet. Keep practicing. And I love that. Like, what a philosophy. Would we expect to play a concerto the first time we sat down at the piano? No, we're lucky to play a scale. So practice. If you want to get good at something, practice it. Practice. Who cares? Mess it up. There was a trainer in this leadership program that I coached in, and she would say, if you're going to F it up with passion. And I love that. Like, so what if you mess up? Just do it with passion. Don't do it timidly. Like, go for it. Go for it. So that's my soapbox for this moment. I think about failure as feedback. Okay, so it's feedback. Okay, this didn't work. Don't throw everything out. Change one variable. Most likely it was your intention. Like, did you set an intention before you took an action? Did you say, this is what I want? And did you decide and like with firm amplitude, like this is what I want. And then you raise your emotions to match that, like be grateful that you have it, or use courage, excitement, passion to enroll others in your ideas, or just gratitude that you have the ability to even try something new out, whatever you're doing. Just if you are able to set a firm intention or have definiteness of purpose, like, this is what I'm here for. I know why I'm here. I know who I'm here to serve. And I'm either going to serve you or somebody else. You choose. And who cares if someone says no, right? Like, if you know what you're here to do, who you're here to serve, what problems you solve, not everybody fits your clientele. Not everybody is your ideal client. And not everyone's going to relate to you. Not everybody's ready for you because you're something else. Not everyone's going to be at your level of frequency. But if they want what you have, keep showing up. Keep showing up and people are going to notice. And they're going to say, okay, I want what you have. Give it to me. So if something doesn't work, change one variable. Just like a scientist, they wouldn't throw out the entire experiment. They would change one small thing. Let's try this. Or like Thomas Edison with the light bulb. He didn't change everything. He changed one thing at a time and checked it. The easiest things for us to check are what are our thoughts and what are our emotions, and really pay attention to that. Like, what are your emotions around it? Because if it's motivated by fear and any of its derivatives, anger, frustration, irritation, nervousness, anxiety, any of those things, you're most likely not going to succeed the first time until you can get those nerves under control and realize that fear is the number one tactic of the ego or the negative parts of us that want to keep us safe. And what's fascinating to me is safety for the ego is more of the same, because the same didn't kill you before. So it has nothing to do with keeping you safe from rejection or atrophy, playing small, dimming your light. It has nothing to do with that. Because if you want to succeed, if you want to be big, if you want to live on purpose, life on your terms, you get to be courageous. You get to do things that are going to be scary, that you don't know if are going to work. And you get to be willing to do them anyway. So does your desire outweigh your fear of failure? If it does, if you're getting tired enough of more of the same or of living small or seeing other people succeed in something you know you're better at, that's a good one, huh? If you see somebody succeeding in something you know you're called for, you're like, oh, I wish I could do that. And then you start criticizing them. Oh, that's a big one. Instead of criticizing those people, look for what they're doing well and think, oh my gosh, they're laying footprints in the field, the quantum field for me to just step in. I just get to follow their path to success because they've already done it. And I'm not saying to imitate anybody because that doesn't work, but knowing that somebody else is succeeding in something that you want to do, it's energetically, it lays footprints for you to just walk in. And I don't mean imitation. I just want to get that clear. Don't steal anybody's stuff. Don't do exactly what they did because that's not right for you. You get to develop a relationship with your higher self, with God, source, universe, and ask, okay, what would you have me do? What would you have me do? And if you are truly trusting your relationship and your connection to the divine, you're not worried about failing. You can't fail. You can't, because every single thing that you do, every choice that you make will be used for you in some way, if you're willing to look at it. And if you fail, there is a universal law that says there is a seed of advantage that is equal to the level of the failure. So you get to look at it. Okay, what is the advantage of me failing at this, in this moment, at this time? What is it? What did you gain? What kind of wisdom did you glean? Most of us just sweep those under the rug and run for the hills. We're like, oh gosh, I don't want to look at that. That means that I'm a failure. If I failed or if one of my endeavors failed, that means I am a failure. And that is such a load of crap. It's another device the ego uses to keep you playing small. So don't fall for it. Know that your success is guaranteed. In fact, take that on as your motto. My success is guaranteed by God, period. God wants you to succeed. And a lot of us are pigheaded. Like, nope, I got this, God. No, that's all right. I got it. I'm gonna do it my way. I'm gonna do it the way I've done it before 20 times that failed, for example. So be willing to do the thing that's not logical. If you're guided to do something by God, source, universe, your higher power, do it, even if it's weird. Like, I was listening to this book on tape. It's not tape, whatever, Audible. And the guy was saying, all of a sudden you like heard a voice that said, you know, borrow this amount of money, go get a fancy hotel room. And this guy was broke. And go to Pittsburgh. I mean, which was hours and hours and hours away, like an 8-hour drive or something. So he's like, what? That's so weird. And then he waited for his instruction. He did the thing. And he ended up making so much money. But it was so illogical for somebody that had no money, that felt like a complete and utter failure, to borrow the money to rent a very expensive hotel room in a city where he didn't think he knew anybody. I mean, it's really bizarre, the things you might be guided or instructed to do. So I'm going to share this with you. I share it a lot, but my prayer is simple. A lot of times what I like to do is I journal. So if you have a busy mind, which most of us do, just do a mind dump. Get a journal and just go like vomit all over the page and keep going. Do not lift your pen. Just keep writing. Even if you write, I don't know what to write. I don't know what to write. And in The Artist's Way by Julia Cameron, she says to write 3 pages. And her big thing is to do stream of consciousness, like the moment you wake up, to start writing 3 pages, because it's like you're in that in-between brainwave state. You're not in beta where you're like ready to go and, you know, doing all the things. You're not quite in theta. You might be in theta or in alpha. So you're kind of in between sleep and awake, but you're in a very relaxed state and the subconscious mind is wide open to you. You get to see what's in there, what's been running the show, you know, the Wizard of Oz behind the curtain. You get to have a glimpse of what's in there. So that's a really great book. If you haven't done that book, I highly recommend it. The Artist's Way by Julia Cameron. Really good way to get inside, like what's going on in there. What are the programs that are running you? That you think you're in control, but 95% of everything you think, feel, believe, and do comes from the subconscious mind, below your level of consciousness. You're not even aware that you're doing these things, thinking these things, feeling this way. So it's good to get aware. So I do a mind dump if I'm at all confused. Okay, what should I do? Even if I'm not confused, I'll do sometimes a mind dump. If my mind is not busy, I just simply get still, quiet my mind. I focus on the space because I'm so used to doing Joe Dispenza. So I focus on the blackness. I put on my eye shades. I was looking for them. I thought they were nearby. Put on my eye shades and I focus on space or blackness or the void until I forget who I am. I forget my identity. I forget that I have a body. I forget what time it is, what day it is, what month it is, where I'm sitting, like my location. I forget what time it is. I forget all the things that identify me in the third dimensional reality. And then I ask, what would you have me do? What would you have me do? And I write it because that is how I hear my guidance. What would you have me do? And I write the answer. If I'm out and about, I don't write it because I don't have anything to write on. So I just ask, what would you have me do? What would you have me say and to whom? Where would you have me go? I mean, just trust yourself to ask the right questions, but you're asking for guidance. Like, even say, I don't know what to do. I am lost. I'm feeling lost. Guide me. Show me what to do next. And you might get one step. If you're fortunate, and I believe it is your birthright to get a step. Okay, so don't think that this is a special skill you get to hone in on. When you are open for it and you ask for it, you will receive guidance. It is not going to come the way mine comes. It will come the way it comes to you. It might be a feeling in your body. It might be a picture in your mind. It might be a sound. I hear things most of the time. Sometimes I'll get a picture, but usually I hear words. So I write them down. And then take action. Do the thing. Do the thing. And once you do it, ask, what was I supposed to learn here? What was the purpose of me doing this thing? And ask for guidance. Like, show me what the meaning of this is. And what next? So you don't have to have the whole big picture. You get to know what you want. Okay, at the end of your life, what do you want to have accomplished, or who do you want to be? But you don't have to know how to get there. In fact, the how is in your business. That's the fun part. That's a part you get to play with. You get to co-create with Source. Ugh, is there anything more beautiful than that? Co-creating with Source. I love it. Another thing is I've been really, really feeling into my oneness with God. And I have gotten visuals on this that have been just mind-blowing, where I saw my heart and the heart of God connected, like they were glowing, and I saw them connected with this cord. And then I saw the hearts of all the other people that were, I was in a healing session, a coherence healing session, and I saw the hearts of all the other healers and all the people that were being healed glowing, and then all connected to the heart of God with this glowing cord. And then I saw every heart connected to every single other heart with these glowing cords. And then they all just merged into one. And it was so beautiful. And one of the visualizations that really supports me, and I use it during meditation when I start to think again that I'm an individual, that I'm Karen Seltz, whatever, that I'm a female, whatever, I will use this visualization. And it is like a drop of foam on ocean water. That's me as an individual individuating. So I'm coming apart away from the whole of the ocean, which is God. And then a wave will come in and bring me right back. And I dissolve into oneness. And I can feel that dissolving back into oneness. It's so lovely. And it's just like this, it feels like I'm supported on every side. I'm part of the whole. And I am just pure love. That's all there is. And it feels like truth, because it is truth. It's 100% truth. And when you reach that point, you will feel it in every cell of your body. You'll feel that this is true. This is true. I am one. I am one with God. I'm one with everything. And I know there are lots of jokes about it, but when you experience it, you can't unknow it. You can't. And it feels like I'm home. I'm home. And then I'm at home even when I'm not in meditation, because I know I bring it with me. Like, I know that I'm supported. I know that God has got my back no matter what. And I know there's no difference between me and anybody I see out here. So if I can extend that level of love that I felt from Source to everybody I meet, then it's been a good day. It's been a good day. And if I can do that every day, it's been a good life, my friends. It's been a good life. So my invitation to you today is to examine your failures like a scientist would, and see them as feedback, and just ask the questions like, okay, what variable could I change? And invite God in. Don't do this by yourself. It's like that Einstein quote, you can't change a problem with the same level of consciousness that created it. You got to go to a higher level of consciousness, or invite somebody else in to show you like where you're being crazy, because we all are. We're all insane if we're doing it on our own. So invite God in and say, okay, which variables should I change? And it could be something really simple. It could be a smile on your face, because when you smile, you produce certain chemicals in your body, which raise your emotional frequency. So try smiling, smiling, smiling. And if you would like any support at any time, please email me or message me or comment. And I will be sure to get back to you. Thank you so much for watching Irresistible You, Ignite Your Passion and Purpose. This has been Karen Seltz. I'll see you right here next week.